हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट शरद वजे, कमिंग बिफोर यू अगेन ऑन द प्रोफेशनल मिसकंडक्ट वेरियस क्लॉजेस फ्रॉम शेड्यूल वन पार्ट वन. वी आर कंप्लीटिंग टुडे एंड विल बी स्टार्टिंग विथ शेड्यूल वन पार्ट टू एज वेल एज पार्ट थ्री एंड इफ पॉसिबल द लास्ट पार्ट फोर ऑफ द फर्स्ट शेड्यूल. नाउ द क्लॉज 12, द लास्ट क्लॉज ऑफ Schedule 1, Part 1 reads like this. A chartered accountant in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he allows a person not being a member of the institute in practice or a member not being his partner to sign on his behalf or on behalf of the firm any balance sheet, profit and loss account, report or financial statements. That means the balance sheet, profit and loss account, reports and financial statements must be signed by the member or a partner of a firm of which he is also a partner. That means in case of a partnership firm, if A, B are two partners, if the audit is done by A and the balance sheet, profit and loss account, that means financial statements or report is issued in the name of or signed by B, it is permissible. If the audit is done by A individual as a proprietor, then it must be signed by A individual as proprietor. It cannot be signed by any other person. What I mean to say that the audit report or financial statements are not allowed to be signed by any other person other than a partner himself or any other partner of the same firm, not any employee, not even qualified chartered accountant employed with the firm. It must be signed by the partner or proprietor as the case may be, and not by employee professional in these situations. However, there are exceptions that have been provided, and exceptions are common sense exceptions, we can say that. Like audit queries can be raised by audit assistant, need not be that audit query letter or information, additional information to be sought from the auditee concerned must be signed by the partner or by the proprietor. It can be signed by any other employee or qualified employee of the firm. So audit queries can be raised by any person. He can ask for any additional information in the form of questionnaire also. He can also sign a letter forwarding the draft observations and financial statements. He can send draft observations. He can send financial statements in the form of a covering letter, but the financial statements itself are not to be signed by any person other than a proprietor and or a partner. He can acknowledge any receipt received in the office of the chartered accountant or a professional. He can receive or he can give acknowledgement. Then he can issue receipt on behalf of the firm for the professional fees received. If he has gone to the audit for any other, for the cash verification in a bank branch or at a bank or at a client's place, then even audit assistant or any other person can verify the cash and sign the necessary documents having verified the cash on behalf of the firm. He can issue acknowledgement for records received for the purpose of audit or for the purpose of tax filing. He can raise the bill also. He can issue acknowledgement for having received the money also. That means all these things, or he can attend the routine matter with the income tax authorities, like filing the income tax return, which was previously done physically, or submission of any letter, submission of any document, submission of any challan. All these things can be done under the signature of any other person with the organization of the professional, but the balance sheet, profit and loss account, reports and financial statements must be signed by the concerned proprietor or a partner in a firm. One partner can sign on behalf of or for other partner, that is permissible. Obviously, the institute has also given the format for such signature. You have to write firm name, that is for XYZ and company, or associates or whatever the case may be. Below that, chartered accountants. Below that, FRN number, firm registration number. Then space for signature. Then name of the person who is signing it and his status, whether as a proprietor, as a partner, and below that, the membership number, and obviously UDIN wherever is required. So basic objective is to sign by the proprietor or a partner. Some 25, 30 years back, there was a concept of signing it in the name of the firm. That means if the auditor is XYZ and company, then I have seen some balance sheets, profit and loss accounts, and statement like wherever the signature is there, XYZ and Co. Now the institute has come out and state specifically what you have to state, name of the firm, chartered accountants, FRN number, name, proprietor or partner, and membership number. In no other way a person can put his signature as a professional on the reports or financial statements issued by him. That concludes first 12 items applicable under Schedule 1, Part 1, applicable to practicing chartered accountant or practicing professional, company secretary or cost accountant, as the case may be, excepting one clause. All other clauses are same. I'm not using even the word similar, are same with other two professions, namely cost accountants and company secretaries. Now, today we'll start with Schedule 1, Part 2, as applicable to members in service. That means those who are not in practice, those who are employed. For them, there are only two items included in the list. The list one says, the first clause says, a member of the institute shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he, being an employee of any company, firm or person, pays or allows or agrees to pay directly or indirectly to any person any share in the emoluments of the employment undertaken by him. That means if a person is employed and if he pays or agrees to pay any share in his emoluments, certain amounts, to the employer or to any person, it will be treated as a professional misconduct. In a sense, he has been employed by a company on a salary of rupees 1 lakh, which is reasonable. But the director of a company says that your salary will be rupees 2 lakhs provided you give back to me 1 lakh rupees. He may be requiring that 1 lakh rupees for any other purpose. We are not concerned with that. Now, in this case, his 2 lakh salary is shared, his emoluments are shared with any other person. It is prohibited, and this is a case of a professional misconduct. However, if a professional approaches a concern or an organization who gives employment, like monster.com, naukri.com, etc., and he himself registers with such organizations and seeks assistance in getting the job, and he pays whatever the amount that is permissible because there is no sharing of his emoluments, he is paying in advance for getting the service of getting the job for him. So this is permissible. That is my personal opinion. Then the clause 2 reads like this. A member of the institute shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he, being an employee of any company, firm or person, accepts or agrees to accept any part of fees, profits or gains from a lawyer, a chartered accountant or a broker engaged by such company, firm or person, or agent or customer of such company, firm or a person, by way of commission or gratification. So wherever a professional, say a CFO of an organization, appoints a firm of auditors, say X, that the last auditor we paid a fees of 50,000 rupees, now I'll ensure that your fees are 1 lakh rupees, but you have to part with 50% of the additional or increased amount. Then only I'll appoint you. Now, this is a professional misconduct on the part of the concerned auditor also, as well as it is a professional misconduct on the part of the CFO also, on the part of the employer also, because he is seeking part of the fees, profits or gains from a lawyer or a chartered accountant or broker or any other agent. It is not restricted to it. That means even if a cost accountant is there, it is covered by any other agent. If it is a broker, if it is a company secretary, his position is also covered, that if an employee shares the fees paid to another professional in any manner, it will be treated as a professional misconduct. Now, for this purpose, whether the concerned employee is in part-time employment or full-time employment or part-time practice or full-time practice is immaterial. Then, these are only two clauses in part two. Even in practice, I have experienced almost zero complaints against the employee professionals, because who is going to make a complaint? The employer himself, and the concerned employee professional works as per the directions of the employer, then obviously the question of filing complaint may not arise. But I have not handled any case on behalf of employee professional, but mostly or almost all are with respect to the professional in practice. Then clause 3 deals with the members generally. That means schedule 3 is applicable to both practicing as well as non-practicing professionals. Clause 3 reads like this: a member of the institute, whether in practice or not, shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he, not being a fellow of the institute, acts as a fellow of the institute. Very simple to understand per se. If you are not a fellow, but if you state that you are a fellow of the institute, then it will be a professional misconduct. Generally, if having completed 5 years in the profession, you apply for a fellowship. For example, you have completed 5 years today, say on 18th of September 2021. Then on 19th September, you apply to the institute for a fellowship, and you get a letter from the institute, say on 10th of October. So from 19th September to 10th of October, technically speaking, whenever the institute gives fellowship, it is from the 19th September, from the date on which you have applied, from the date you have complied with. But till you receive a letter, it is advisable that do not use the word fellow anywhere in any communication till you get a specific letter from the institute that you have been admitted as a fellow member of the institute. Then clause 2 of schedule 1, part 3, reads like this: a member of the institute, whether in practice or not, shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he does not supply the information called for or does not comply with the requirements asked for by the institute, council, or any of its committees, director, discipline, board of discipline, disciplinary committee, quality review board, or the appellate authority. That means various persons connected with the institute, various authorities connected with the institute, when called for a specific information from the member, then member must give such information. Failure to give such information will amount to a professional misconduct. For example, a complaint is being made by a company against a professional. As we have discussed in earlier lectures, initial lectures, the director of discipline will send this complaint to the respondent, chartered accountant, or a professional to reply back. The professional simply ignores or does not reply at all. That means the director of discipline has sought for some clarification, some information, and if the respondent professional simply ignores, it will amount to a professional misconduct also under this clause 2, besides the clauses that were complained of by the complainant. Similarly, he has to comply with the requirements asked for. That means before issuing any report, a UDIN is required. This is the requirement asked by the institute. If he issues any report without UDIN being generated within the time permissible or without being UDIN being quoted in the report, then it will also amount to a professional misconduct. Now the clause 4, schedule 1, part 4, has got one clause only. One more clause is there in this clause. Clause 3 reads like this: a member of the institute, whether in practice or not, shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he, while inviting professional work from another chartered accountant, or while responding to the tenders or inquiries, or while advertising through a write-up or anything as provided, gives information knowing to be false. Now, we are required to submit tenders whenever called for, or we have to empanel ourselves. Suppose there is a bank empanelment, and in the bank empanel form, if you write a fellow member, and if you are not, then you are covered by this clause. You are giving information knowing to be false. Or whether you are a DISA qualified or systems audit qualified, if you say yes, when you are not so qualified, it will also be a professional misconduct under this clause. Or in case of empanelment for concurrent audit, if you state that I have done the course for concurrent audit conducted by the ICAI, and when in fact you have not conducted it, that means you are getting the audit on the basis of false information which you are deliberately giving to the bank, it is a professional misconduct. So while applying for any tender, while advertising for which it is permissible, or while seeking any assistance or a job or a work assignment from other chartered accountant, if you give information knowingly to be false, it will amount to a professional misconduct. Now, we have been left with the last one, Schedule 1, Part 4. It has got two clauses to which we'll see next time. Thank you very much.